Hi everyone, my name is Cornelia Nita and I'm researcher at the Laser and Optronics Unit from Department of Communications, Information, Systems and Sensors, Royal Military Academy. And in today's webinar, I will present to you some of the insights of application of deep learning methods for ship traffic surveillance. So in maritime domain, the safety and security focus on techniques and solutions able to support a safe navigation, to control maritime traffic, and also to detect any illegal activities that are taking place. And unfortunately, these illegal activities are taking place quite often. Here are some examples. On the left side are some images with a PECMA vessel displaying the fake name Puma. We can observe on the bottom image that the true name is partially painted over hull. On the right side is an example of identity fraud. Here the authorities in Mauritius use images to determine that a vessel was using a fraudulent identity, during a call in Port Louis. The analysis of these images, together with the automatic identification data, was able to confirm the vessel real identity. In photo A, the real Kerya Wijaya 201 in Port Louis is shown. In photo B, a vessel that called into Port Louis later on, several months later, falsely claiming the same name. And in photo C is the same vessel documented earlier in that year using the real identity. With green, I represented here similarities, and with red, I represented those differences. So when we compare photos A and B, we can clearly see the difference in the shape of the stern, but also of the hull. Also, the name of vessel in photo B differs from the version of the name recorded in authorized vessel list, having in addition the letter NO. By contrast, when we compare the photos B and C, we observe that the shape of the stern and of the hull are matching very well. And we can notice also some distinctive markings on the hull in both images, caused possible by rust. Another illegal activity taking place very often overseas is the ship-to-ship fraud. And on the left side is the Yusan vessel, and a small vessel of unknown nationality, the blue one, lying alongside each other and connected hoses. The picture was from March 2019. On the right image, two vessels suspected by transfer fraud. In the image on the right, we have John M.A. Sun vessel trying to hide its identity by painting the funnel in white, different than how it's in registry. Also, we can notice a changing in the International Maritime Organization number. This is a seven-digit number, a unique seven-digit number, which remain unchanged through a vessel lifetime. So if we are looking carefully, we see that the digit 3 is changed into digit 8. Also, we notice that the truth name is hidden by a painted over displaying a different name and port of register. So analyzing all these images shown here help us to detect and to prove these illegal activities. So to ensure that all the activities taking place in the maritime domain are safe, secure, and environmentally sustainable, various tools are used to monitor vessels' movement, to have information on the position data received from the system in such a way that we detect the activity of the vessel, but also the behavior of this vessel. So to the right picture, I represent here a schematic presentation of the components used by an operator into a workstation. So from all the components presented here, we have a radar, AIS base station. We'll focus on the data gathered by the video surveillance system. So the presentation outline, I will start with a description of the problem formulation and the research strategy, then some insights on artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning concept. Next, super resolution. Also ship detection and segmentation, text detection and recognition, and people detection tasks are discussed in the maritime context. Then we'll have the results obtained with some selected models, the conclusions, and some remarks presentation. Here are some examples of the data gathered by a camera located at the entrance of a port, or by a camera on the board of a vessel on the right side. We can notice that weather conditions, the light conditions, the resolution of our electro-optical sensors used play an important role in the surveillance. Currently, the operator are manually annotating and analyzing the footages. A process which require a lot of attention and cognitive workloads. So the surveillance camera, we have to take into account that also they are working 24 hours per day. So very large data are recording in this process. And what is also important to say is that this recording data are not currently exploited to provide information on the ship encounter during the monitoring or also to detect any sources that can pose a serious threat to the electro-optical sensor used. So our goal here is to improve data gathering and to decrease the response time to anomalous events. And the question is what we can do here. What we can do? The answer is that we can automate the task of the operator. And that he's performing. And here we illustrate a schematic representation of an automated system dedicated to maritime surveillance and traffic monitoring. So what we want to do is to use the infrared and visible sensor data and to create a system that provides automatic operational demands like ID reader, signature extraction, activity and people detection through artificial intelligence algorithms. And all these demands together with automatic identification system data and under human intelligence supervision will automate ship identification and detection of activity of a vessel. So our aim here is to create the basis for an automated detection and reporting of changes in activity of the identified ships. And how we want to do this? Through artificial intelligence. So now let's go and have some insights on what artificial intelligence can do to help us. People are discussing about AI, machine learning, deep learning, but often these terms are mixed up. So artificial intelligence is the main concept, where machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence and deep learning is a subset of machine learning. Artificial intelligence will enable computers, robots, and machines to exhibit human-like intelligence and to mimic the perception of the human brain. They use a set of rules that we are calling algorithm to direct machine to complete task and to solve problems. So besides machine learning and deep learning, other subfields of artificial intelligence are fuzzy logic, evolutionary computations, robotics, and so on. Then we have machine learning, and machine learning is a subset of AI that learns by itself. The application consists of neural networks in which the statistical learning algorithm automatically learn and improve from experience. And these machine learning algorithms are classified in three main categories, represented on the right side of this slide. Is a schematic representation of them. So we have supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So in supervised learning, a model is developed using a known input data and a known response. Then the model can generate predictions or draw conclusions for a new data set. Unsupervised learning is about unsorted and unlabeled data. This time, the algorithm will analyze the patterns in the dataset without referring to any known output. So they are mostly used to identify data clusters and for a reduction of the dimension. Then we have reinforcement learning involving a trial and error process in which the algorithm learns through interactions with the environment. So they use feedback from previous action and experience to adjust the future responses. And finally, we have deep learning. And in deep learning, these times the models are built on deep neural networks with multiple hidden layers in which every layer will refine the conclusions from the previous layer. And this is done through a process called forward propagation. We have also the inverse process, back propagation. In this process will be the errors and the weights assigned in the previous layer are identified, and then these are helping to train the model. There are different types of neural networks, and here we are referring to long short-term memory networks, recurrent neural networks, recursive neural networks, generative adversarial networks, and also the convolutional neural network. What is interested us most, because these are mainly used for image processing and object detection. So in order to understand how a deep neural network works, I will start with an example on how we can recognize an image. When we are looking at the image from top left, where we have a vessel there, depending on the background of everyone, we'll recognize that in the photo is a boat. Someone will say, okay, this is an M-class vessel. Somebody else will say, okay, this is a pilot service vessel, M-class boat. What is happening is that the primary visual cortex is packed with a lot of cells in many, many layers, and just as in retina case, and the information is processed there. So when we are looking on how machines can classify an image, we directly look at convolutional neural network, as I said before, because this one is the most used deep learning method for analyzing and classifying images. We cannot do a parallelism with a human brain, as it is a big unknown, but the convolutional neural network operations, like convolution pooling, are inspired by the human brain. So it's trying to mimic how some cells react to certain ages, to certain light pattern, dark pattern, and so on. So let's define the most important components of a neural network. Technically, an image comes into the computer in the form of an array. An array that has dimension depends on the pixel values, on the height, on the width, and also the number of color channels. And this is equal with 3 for a common RGB color image. Then the convolutional layer will extract features from raw images by applying a filter, which is a relatively small matrix as is shown in the middle images. And then this array is scanned by the filter. When an input image passed through a convolutional layer, it's convolved by each filter and gives a relatively small size output matrix called feature map. This feature map matrix will summarize the presence of detected features in the input, like vertical edges, horizontal edges, and different patterns. So after convolution, this obtained feature map will go to a nonlinear operation process, which is done by a rectified linear unit function. This is activation function. So on the top right image, it is shown that the function returns 0 if it receives any negative input. So in this way, we can also find a new pattern in the image. Then we have the pooling layer. And the pooling layer is the role of this layer is to reduce the dimension of the feature maps obtained from the convolutional layer while retaining the important information. So in practice, there are different type of pooling methods adopted in a convolutional neural network. We have max pooling, average pooling, or sum pooling. Then, after this information was passed through convolutional layer, pooling layer, rectifying activation layer, then the vector is fed into a regular fully connected neural network to obtain the final recognition results. So the before going there, we flat the matrices. Instead of a matrix layer, the flattening will produce a very, very long vector. In the fully connected network, what is the role of this layer is to translate image recognition task into a probability classification task. And usually this is done by applying a softmax regression model to accomplish this classification. Another important component of the model is the optimization method. This is used to change the attribution of your network, such as the weight and learning rate, in order to reduce the losses. So the cost function, the losses, because this is an optimization problem, are trying to quantify how bad or how good your model are predicting your data. And some of the optimization algorithms used in the process of training the neural network are gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, or ADEM, adaptive moment estimation. On the top right, we have a schematic representation on how a model is created. So you have your raw data, and then you split this raw data after you clean the images in a training set, validating set, testing set. Then the neural network architecture is selected together with the hyperparameters like number of features, size of features, or window, number of strides, how many layers, and in what order. We train this neural network on the training set to obtain the model that will be tuned with the validation set. And the final model, presented schematically on the top, on the bottom right, is going to be used for prediction on a new data. So your convolutional neural network will recognize that This image represents a pilot or a service vessel. Also, it's important to define some of the terms later in the presentation. So we have ship classification term, is the task of identifying that in that image we have a vessel. We have vessel localization, which involves the class label and the coordinates of the bounding box to show where the ship is located in the image. We have a vessel detection, which involves localization of multiple vessels, may not be from the same class, so we can have objects from different classes. And then a ship segmentation involves the class label, the outline of the label of the ship, this is to find the pixels that are part of the ship. So let's go and take the first step and look on what was the task that we are interested in beginning. And this task was the super resolution. So due to the optical distortion, due to the aliasing, motions, blur, and noise, the original scene is captured by the image acquisition system, having a much lower quality. So you'll end up with a blurred, noisy, aliased, low resolution image, depending on your electro-optical sensor used. So you have information loss. This means that your low resolution image will limit many tasks that maybe the user wanted to apply to this image. So we are in a situation where we want to overcome this and the mode is to apply a super resolution. So to exchange enhance the quality of the image. And on the right side photo, I present to you an example where a thermal image was before and after a super resolution processing. So if anything were hidden behind the trees, the super resolved image right will reveal it. So to improve the quality of the image coming from the sensors, there we can choose from a class of techniques to recover this information. So we can use the information from multiple frame of a scene called multi-frame super resolution. A scheme is presented in a right picture, where we can use as an input a low resolution image and upscaling to that of a high resolution one. And this is called single image super resolution. An example of a single image super resolution is the most simple neural network used, is called SRCNN, and is presented in the left scheme of this slide. So actually, the network is not deep at all. If we are looking, there are only three parts. We have patch extraction and representation, nonlinear mapping, and reconstruction as shown in the figure. So as an input, the low resolution image is by cubic interpolated into a Y variable, and with the same size as the high resolution image, X. And then the model will aim to learn a mapping that is taking the image from Y and is going to a high resolution one, X. So what we will do in the first layer, we have a standard convolutional layer with rectifying linear activation function, then a nonlinear mapping that will map the low resolution vector to high resolution vector, and after the mapping, we'll have to reconstruct the image, so we'll do a convolution again. In this slide, we show to you the results of applying two super resolution methods to this to the input from the left side image. So in the middle is the result after the simplest single super resolution method is applied. And in the right image is the frame after a multi-frame super resolution method, ADVR, is applied. So here the information is coming from 5 frames into we take it into consideration in order to super resolve the frame that I'm showing here to you. The results show that the multi-frame super resolution method is performing best, is receiving, is recovering information from all the sequences tested, all 5 frames, and then we have improvement in the text area if we zoom in the text area, but also on the shape contours, on the colors, and so on. A video to compare the input sequences and the super resolve one are presented on the this slide. Please note that the edges are better defined, as well as the colors, the waves are smudged out. But overall, the super resolve video is not so super resolve as we expect, as the name is saying. And this is happening because we need to take into account that we use the information from a limited number of low resolution images. And this limitation is evident, but also we have to take into account that we cannot obtain extra information other than what is contained by the low resolution images. Also, what we want to stress here is that even the method can perform very well on some data on the right-hand side, we also notice that we have some artifacts. Artifacts that appears in our results caused by compression. And it is known that the super resolution method tends to generate significant artifacts when operating on heavily compressed images or videos. What we can do to handle these compressed videos, one potential solution is to first denoise the image to remove the compression artifacts in the image before applying one of the state-of-the-art super resolution video method. Or we can train on the compressed video already, or improve the method used. Next to that, we went to a different task, the task of heap detection and segmentation. And to do this, we use mask RCNN method. So we want to perform a pixel-wise classification to find those pixels that are part of the vessel. This method was developed on the top of Faster RCNN. Faster RCNN is the state of the art for object detection. And we extend this method with a branch that predicts the object mass. It has 2 stages. The first stage will scan the image and generate proposal regions likely to contain the vessel, whereas the second stage will classify this proposed regions and generates bounding box using the bounding box refinement method and mask using the ROI align method. So the method will take as input video sequences and returns a series of pixel-wise masks of the ship, the class label with a confidence score, and also will predict the bounding boxes, so the vessel detection. We use for this the Matterport TensorFlow implementation. We have an architecture of ResNet 101. It's pre-trained on MS COCO dataset and is fine-tuned for a ship class on our own data. On the right side, there are some images from the annotation process. So to create the training data set, we need to manually annotate the images. And this annotation will contain the region attribute. So this means the class and the shape of the object of interest. So all the contours of your vessel. Next, we test the method on video of vessels under different conditions, under haze conditions, under large wave conditions, small vessel detection and segmentation, but also generalization. So on the bottom video, we have a Singapore Maritime Dataset test. We have to, I will say here that this data set was not used for training, so the results will show also how the method is generalizing here. Also, we test on different cases like occlusion or overlapping, but also on thermal infrared data. We can see that the results shows high accuracy. So this leads us to the following conclusions on applying the mask RCNN method to maritime surveillance data, that we obtain accurately segmentation and detection results. When we have complex backgrounds, we have an accuracy of 86%. We noticed some limitations on predicting the mask when occlusion at the image border occurs. We have pre-trained weights representing a good starting point for training. No extensive fine-tuning was needed there. And also showing to you the results on Singapore Maritime Dataset is also showing that we have a generalization to other datasets. On the right side of this slide, I have sequences of mask RCNN results shown to you here. And please watch them carefully and notice if any things that are not supposed to be there are shown in this video. So did you notice something? Did you notice that in one of the frames, a vessel is appearing somewhere in the sky? What I want to show you here is that, in fact, a bird is sometimes seen as a challenge in the maritime domain, because sometimes the deep learning models are predicting the bird as being a vessel. Note, however, that this was an isolated result in our test data. This was the single case where it happened. But I wanted to underline that also can happen. Then what you can notice also is that on the thermal data, right on this frame, the last frame, the small vessel behind the cargo vessel is not detected and is not mass classification. So we cannot do that. And the problem is because we populate our training data set with only visible imagery. So again, thermal infrared was for the generalization of the method. The next step will be to apply it also to training thermal infrared images. Next step is going further and try to detect the plate. Try to identify the name of the vessel. This will help us in identification task. Or sometimes not the name, but identification number of the vessel. And here I'm trying to underline the fact that this task is very challenged because you can have various fonts, sizes, colors, resolutions, and so on. I have different crop images on the left side showing you the data set used for training, in contrast with car plate recognition. The characters here are painted or printed directly on the vessel body. Also, despite some recommendation regarding the size, minimum height that the text can have, there are different aspects that we have to take into consideration. So you have complex background, you can have multi-oriented text or distortion of the text due to the bow design. Also, camera location plays an important role. So you need to take into account that sometimes also this text can become unreadable due to the external factors like rust, peeling, paint, corrosion, or improper painting. So here we need again to create a dataset. For this task, and we need again to manually annotate to draw the bounding box around the text area and also to indicate the text that is there. So an image of the annotation process is presented on the right hand side of this slide. For the text detection, we test various algorithms from which EAST was model is was the most capable of predicting words and line scores very well, line scene, sorry. So we had EAST with for is very good in predicting text on 720 pixels images. It can run in real time. We have the overall architecture of his model on this slide, on the right hand side slide. Firstly, if you look there, you'll see that on the top the feature maps are extracted using convolutional layers. Then the text detection module is built on top of the feature map, predicting the text bounding boxes. You have the non-maximum suppression module used to remove any redundant bounding boxes and to retain only the positive ones. And then you have the output of the text detection stage, which consists in the coordinates of the bounding boxes and the classification class, if it's a word or non-word. So this text region will fed up then into the text recognition module. Again, we use a model that was pre-trained on a specific data set, on large data set, ICDAR 213 and 215. And we have ResNet backbone architectures, and then we fine tune on our own data. For the performance evaluation, we use the precision, recall, and F1 score metrics. Precision is the measure for efficiency and represents the probability of the predicting bounding boxes matching actual ground truth boxes. Recall is a measure of effectiveness, and apologies. F1 score represents the harmonic mean between precision and recall. We test three methods. The first one is LTR algorithm, localized text region algorithm, is based on simple morphological operation and contour properties, so it's not a neural network at all. Then we have a pre-trained craft, a pre-trained EAST, and a fine-tuned EAST. So from the figure right, we observed that the fine-tuned EAST model clearly outperform the other algorithm, obtaining an F1 score of 82% and a precision of 84%. When looking at the algorithm based on simple image processing techniques, LTR, it is clear that the traditional approaches are inaccurate in prediction those regions with text being in a non-standardized structure and size. Also, we checked the statistics of detecting an undetected text region. We observed that for text and height interval 1544 pixels in the images, we have high probability to detect this text for a text that has a height less than 14 pixels, then the percentage to detect is decreased to 50%. Note that in our current training set, the occurrence to have a text height in interval 1524 were quite high, as you can see on the left image on the bottom. And also we took into consideration the artifacts. The artifacts are those region false positive. And next we present the performance of text recognition methods. Here we check the edit distance. This metric is defined to as minimum number of operation required between two strings in order to transform one word into another one, and also the percentage of word recognitions correctly recognized. The tests are done on two sets. apologies. A challenging data set with 700 images and a data set with only 200 images having adequate contrast and visibility. So it's clear that the better the quality of your images, then the easier it is to distinguish the characters from the rest and to have a higher accuracy in doing that. So we test two methods. We test the Tesseract OCR method, and a method based on a thin plate spline transformation, having as a backbone architecture the ResNet and a bidirectional long shorter memory model. We see that the Tesseract OCR performs best. We notice that a common error in our results is the falsely classified digit and characters, and this can happen due to distortions. Some characters can have similar shapes with other symbols or digits. You can see for the Dordrecht, in this case, R is recognized as falsely being letter A. Also on the image with VH 108, the ground truth is 108, but however, the prediction is 103. Therefore, I think to ensure the high accuracy of your model, the system should work with an existing database. So the ship identification will achieve a higher confidence score if a matching between the predicted text and the register vessel inscription will exist there. Everything will be much easier in this case. Another task that we were interested is people detection. This will help us in trying to detect the activity and the behavior of a vessel. And to do this, we can apply different models. Here an example of applying the featured descriptor histogram of oriented gradient. The basic idea is presented on the left side of the image. So you have a picture, and this picture is scanned with a detection window of different size. For each position and size of the detection window, then this window is subdivided in cells. And in every cell, you'll calculate the gradients in every pixel. Okay, so it happens that typically the cells can contain a small part of the person to be detected. How you can do that, how you detect that this it happens. Your gradient that is computed in each pixel will be plug in a histogram, so we'll fill in a histogram, and then these histograms are put together and put in the fed into a machine learning discriminator to decide whether the cells of the current detection window corresponds to a person or not. You need to take into account that this method was developed for pedestrian detection. In this case, humans are mostly standing up and are fully visible. This is not the case for our TESTA and for our maritime context, because person detection is particularly difficult here, mainly because of high variability of appearances, possible different situation, and so on. On the right hand side, I'm presenting here some examples of people detection. We can clearly see that in some cases the method performs well on middle image, on the top image. However, on the right images, the case on the bottom at least, the method is giving very bad results also. So if we have to go to the conclusion for this case that we need to improve the method, maybe to go to the state of the art object detection, like faster RCNN method, or try other different methods. This leads us to the conclusions and remarks and our takeaway message. So our takeaway message is that deep learning-based models can generate high confidence scores on a variety of real maritime complex situation and tasks. We showed to you that we can have more than 86% precision in vessel detection using mask RCNN method. We can have also scores of more than 80% in text detection and text recognition using state-of-the-art YEAST model, respectively Tesseract OCR. And at the same time, we showed to you that we can have also less accurate results when we have unrepresentative data samples. To-do list, we have tracking, classification, AIS fusion, and also improvement of the algorithm that we already presented to you. So try different models there for different tasks. What we want to stress also is the need for larger training and testing data sets, in visible but also in thermal spectral ranges. This is on the top priority always. When I'm saying more data, I'm referring that I want better data. So the data to be representative with what I want on what I want to test is very, very important. And the last takeaway message is that AI should augment the human intelligence and not replace it. This algorithm can support the operator in decision making, can increase the maritime situation awareness, and also reduce the operator cognitive workloads. Thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, you can ask me after the webinar. You can reach me also on this email address. Thank you very much.